I am so thankful for this church to open its doors to me and allow me to come and to be with you and to minister the Word of God. I pray that God will give you much grace in these days. Your witness for the Lord is so greatly needed here in South Florida, which is a very important place and a very strategic place in what the Lord is doing in His kingdom. And I just want you to remain strong in the grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. And may He hold up your arms as you hold high the torch of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I was told the evening, the theme, the conference is United by the Gospel. And I can't think of a more wonderful theme for us to have for this opening year of conference of these churches coming together. So, I want you to take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of Philippians, chapter 1. It's many different places we could turn tonight to draw our focus upon the unity of the gospel. But I want you to turn to Philippians, chapter 1. And for our time together tonight, I want us to look at verses 3 through 7 specifically. And as the Lord gives time, perhaps we'll look at a few more verses, but I know for sure that we'll look at verses 3 through 7. I want to begin by reading the passage that will be the focus of our exposition tonight. I'm reading from the New American Standard. Many of you have the English Standard Version, but I will read in the New American Standard. I want to begin in verse 3, Philippians 1, verse 3. As you know, Paul is in his first Roman imprisonment. He is under house arrest. He has been taken here by the Roman Empire. Paul has always wanted to go to Rome and preach the gospel. He had no idea that he would arrive under these circumstances, that he would be a prisoner of Rome. And as Paul is confined, he is here for 2 long years, which is a very long time for a very active man like the Apostle Paul, who has been traversing the Middle East and that part of the known world, Asia Minor, and now in Europe. And he is in chains. There are soldiers that are rotating through his house. He's having to pay the rent for his own house arrest. It's rather humiliating. He has a couple of his men with him, Luke and Timothy and Epaphras. And as he writes, awaiting trial in which he will stand before Caesar, knowing that it could mean his death, execution. As Paul writes these words, you would think he's in a prison. Or, excuse me, you would think he's in a palace and not in a prison. What am I hearing over there? What's that? Oh, the translators. Okay. All right, I'm just curious. I'm not used to people talking over me while I'm while I'm preaching. And so Paul writes, this is one of his prison epistles. But you would think, by reading the tone of what he has to say, you would think that he is in a palace and not in a prison. And it's, I think, even an example for us that wherever we find ourselves in life, whether we're on the mountaintop or whether we're in the valley, there needs to be a vibrant, positive testimony for the Lord Jesus Christ and proclaiming the good news wherever we are. And that's Paul. So I want to begin reading in verse 3. The title of this message is United by the Gospel. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you, always offering prayer with joy in my every prayer for you all, in view of your participation in the gospel from the first day until now. For I'm confident of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. For it's only right for me to feel this way about you, about you all, because I have you in my heart. Since both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers of grace with me. The central theme in this opening chapter of the book of Philippians, I believe, is the gospel. He makes mention of the gospel in verse 5. He talks about our participation in the gospel, that we are in the gospel ministry together, Paul says to the church at Philippi. And we all have our part and we all have our place, and we are all one in the gospel of Jesus Christ. And then in verse 7, he talks about his defense of the gospel and his confirmation of the gospel. And wherever Paul went and wherever Paul was, he was preaching the gospel and he was defending the gospel. And the fact that he is giving a defense means that there's resistance and there's opposition to the gospel. And Paul doesn't cave into this and just say, well, it's just a matter of semantics and we're all saying the same thing and you have your God and I have my God and there's different ways to this God. No, Paul is absolutely determined to defend the one true saving gospel of Jesus Christ. And every time he mentions the gospel, he has the definite article "the" in front of it. The gospel, not a gospel, as if there is one of many gospels. Paul speaks of the gospel. Here is the exclusivity of the gospel, that there is only one way of salvation, and that is through Jesus Christ our Lord. And Peter, when he stood before the Sanhedrin, said in Acts 4, verse 12, there's salvation in no other name, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And there is only one way to the Father, and that is through the sinless life and substitutionary death of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so Paul is giving a defense of the gospel in the imperial city of Rome as he is imprisoned. But even as he is under arrest, there is no reverse gear in Paul. He is not backing up. In fact, he will say to the church at Rome in the book of Romans, I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And even though Paul is one against the many, he nevertheless will give a defense of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul is willing to die for the gospel if necessary. He comes down to verse 12 as he continues to weave this central theme of the gospel. And he says, now I want you to know, brethren, that my circumstances have turned out for the greater progress of the gospel. Paul understands that every difficulty and every trial through which he goes is a part of the sovereign plan of God for his life to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul is here imprisoned in Rome. He's not complaining. He's not whining. He's not suffering from a negative spirit. No, he is triumphant. And he says, these circumstances by which I have been arrested and have been brought to Rome, it's all for the greater purpose of advancing the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the same with you and me. No matter where we go, no matter what we do, we are there by divine appointment to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you are taken to the hospital, there is a sense of triumph in which you can say you are there in the hospital to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ and to testify to the doctors and to bear witness to the nurses of the saving grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if driving home you have a flat tire and someone has to come help you fix the tire, witness to them and know it's a part of the advancement of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's the eternal perspective that Paul has here in verse 12. And his suffering was far greater than anything that I just mentioned, as he now is a prisoner of Rome. His life is on the line. He will be standing trial. Caesar has the power of life and death. He doesn't know how this will turn out, but Paul understands that he's riding a wave of destiny. He is here by the Lord's appointment, and it's all about the greater progress of the gospel. I trust that you see your life that way as well. And then in verse 15, he says again, I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. Do you see the gospel there? That's the fourth time in these opening verses that Paul has talked about the gospel. And then when he comes to verse 27, he says, only conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. In other words, it's not enough just to proclaim it and defend it. We must live it. And we must supply a part of the evidence of the saving power of the gospel of Christ. And so five times in this opening chapter, the Apostle Paul has talked about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that really begs the question, what is the gospel? What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? Well, the gospel of Christ is not that you would have your best life now. If your best life is now, then that means you're headed to a place that's going to be far worse, which would be in hell. No, the gospel is all about the person and work of Jesus Christ. The gospel is about the Lord Jesus Christ, born of a virgin, who lived a sinless and perfect life under the law, that he lived in perfect obedience to the law of God, the very law that you and I break day after day after day. He lived in perfect obedience to the law, and it is this righteousness under the law that Christ achieved for us is imputed to our account in the act of justification by faith. When you put your faith in Jesus Christ, the perfection of his obedience under the law of God is what is credited to your account in heaven, as though you have lived in perfect obedience to the law of God your entire life. Have you ever wondered why Jesus didn't just go straight to the cross? Why the 33 years? Why all of these years before the cross? He could have just come to earth for the weekend and won our salvation and turned around and gone back. Why the 33 long years? And the answer is, Galatians 4:4, he was born under the law, born of a woman, that he would fulfill the demands of the law of God that you and I have broken again and again and again. He obeyed in our place, so that his perfect standing before the law of God would now be our perfect standing before the law of God in heaven. And then he went to the cross, and it was his sinless life that qualified him to go to the cross and to stand in the place of guilty, hell-bound sinners. And him who knew no sin, God made to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. And so upon the cross, Jesus was lifted up to die, and all of the sins of all of the people who would ever believe upon the Lord Jesus Christ were transferred to Christ, and he bore our sins in his body upon the cross. And as he bore our sins, he bore the curse of our sin, which is death. And by the shedding of his blood, he satisfied the righteous anger of God toward all who would believe in Jesus Christ. And so there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And we previously were under the wrath of God. We were children of wrath. And we were deserving wrath. And we were perishing. And we were on the road to destruction. But through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, he placated, he propitiated, he appeased, he satisfied the righteous anger of God toward us. There is not one drop of divine wrath that is left for us because of his death. And by the shedding of his blood, he reconciled holy God to sinful man. He stood in the middle as our mediator. He was fully God and able to represent God to us. And he was fully man and able to represent us to God. He was the God-man. There is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave his life a ransom for all. And as he stood between God, holy God, and sinful man through the blood of his cross, he has now reconciled all who put their faith and trust in him. Outside of this reconciliation, we are enemies of God. Outside of this reconciliation, the wrath of God is burning hotly against us. The Bible says that God is angry with the wicked every day. And yet in Christ and through the blood of his cross, we no longer are enemies of God under the wrath of God, but we now have been reconciled and brought into the kingdom of God, and we now are at peace with God, but much more importantly, God is at peace with us. And in this death of Christ upon the cross, he also redeemed us. That means he bought us with the price of his own blood. And he bought us out of the slave market of sin and out of the slavery to Satan. We once were slaves of sin, and we once were slaves of Satan. But through the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, he bought us and has brought us out of our bondage to sin, and he has brought us out from under the tyranny of Satan. And if the Son shall set you free, you shall be free indeed. When he came at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, as he hung upon the cross, he said, "It is finished." He did not say, "I am finished." He said, "It is finished." And the mission of salvation was paid in full, was fully accomplished. The blood of Christ had been shed for our sins. They took him down from the cross. They buried him in a borrowed tomb. And on the third day, by all of the authority that resided in himself as the Son of God, he raised himself from the dead. And God the Father raised him, and God the Holy Spirit raised him. The entire Trinity was involved in that bodily resurrection. And Jesus Christ came walking out of that tomb with the keys of death and Hades in his hand, and he came walking out a risen, living, victorious Savior. He has ascended back to heaven to the right hand of God the Father, where all authority in heaven and earth have been given unto him. And whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That, in a nutshell, is the gospel. The gospel is all about Jesus Christ. It's all about his sinless life, his substitutionary death, his bodily resurrection, and his present enthronement at the right hand of God the Father. And the word gospel means good news. It is the greatest news that has ever been proclaimed on planet Earth. It is the glad tidings of salvation that have been accomplished in the life and death of the Lord Jesus Christ that is now freely offered without cost to guilty, hell-bound sinners who have no right of participation in this gospel but for the grace of God. So this is the gospel. And all who have put their faith in this gospel, all who have believed upon Jesus Christ, are now united by this gospel. The entire world is really divided between those who have believed the gospel and those who have not believed the gospel. And those of us who have put our faith in this gospel, our lives are fused together, and there is a supernatural unity for us in Christ. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. And we are in the same family of God. And it's a wonderful thing to be one in Christ with people all over the world. Just in these last few months, I have preached in Great Britain, in Northern Ireland. I have preached in Europe, in the Czech Republic. I have preached in Africa, in Zambia, in South Africa. I have preached in Brazil, in various places. I've just flown in from Los Angeles, the other Hollywood out in Los Angeles. I leave here and go to Puerto Rico. I leave Puerto Rico and I'm going into Canada to preach in Edmonton and then over to Vancouver on the Pacific Coast side and then back to Nashville. And wherever I go, there are brothers and sisters with whom I am one. And though our differences are many, we have different color skin, we have different accents, we speak different languages, yet we have all come to one and the same place where we realize that we have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and we have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are now one in Christ, and there is a supernatural unity by which we are made common partakers of this gospel of Jesus Christ. So, as we come together tonight, despite the fact that we belong to different churches, different denominations, different neighborhoods, we nevertheless have a deep and close, intimate relationship in the Lord Jesus Christ. You are my brother, you are my sister, and we will spend all eternity in heaven around the throne of God, worshiping Him who laid down His life for us. Now, in the opening verses of the book of Philippians, Paul talks about this unity. And as we look at verses 3 through 7, there are three main headings that I want to set before you. But as we do, I just want to ask you, are you aware of this unity that we have one with another? And do you practice this unity? Do you reach out in Christian love to others who worship in other places, maybe even worship in other ways, but you are a fellow believer in Jesus Christ, a genuine, true believer? Do you walk in a manner worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Well, let's look now at beginning in verse 3. I'm going to set several headings before you. I want you to note first our partnership in the gospel. That'll be in verse 5, but I want to begin in verse 3 because Paul begins, as he writes the Philippians, by rejoicing in the oneness he shares with them in the gospel and in reality with all believers. Notice how he begins in verse 3. He says, "I thank my God in all my remembrance of you." With every reflection upon these Philippian believers that he has in his heart, he offers thanks to God. For every single one of them. Note, I thank my God in all my remembrance of you. He went there on his second missionary journey. You can read about it in Acts chapter 16. And he went there to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And oh, how he preached the gospel. He went down to a riverside, and there were some women there, and there was Lydia, a seller of purple. And Paul preached the gospel, and the Bible says the Lord opened her heart to believe the gospel. God always goes before us, and he's preparing hearts, and he will open hearts as we step forward by faith and preach the gospel. And that's what Paul did, and Lydia was converted. Then there was a young demon-possessed slave girl. And we have every reason to believe that she too was converted by this gospel. And they took Paul and they threw him into prison. And you recall how there was an earthquake that night. And the Philippian jailer came to Paul and he said, "What must I do to be saved?" And Paul preached the gospel to him. And he said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved." And then he went to the jailer's household and his whole household was saved by this gospel. What power there is in the gospel. And many, many more. What a thrilling thing this was for Paul to see this church supernaturally birthed into the kingdom of God. In the middle of an earthquake, in the middle of the night, God is saving people by this gospel. So he says, "I thank my God in all my remembrances of you." Are you kidding me? Paul could never forget these people. whom God used for him to bring the gospel to them, and they were converted in the midst of this chaos and conflict. And then in verse 4, he says, always offering prayer with joy in my every prayer for you all. And in the midst of this difficulty, in the midst of this pain, confinement, imprisonment, chains, Paul has joy because his joy in the gospel far transcends the difficulties that he has faced. Though his body is in shackles, his spirit is soaring to the heights of heaven. And now he comes to verse 5, and he really gives the reason why he is so joyful as he prays for them. And in verse 5 he says, in view of your participation in the gospel from the first day until now. The first day refers to the day of their conversion. Going back to Lydia, and there at the riverside as she was converted, and continuing person by person and soul by soul, Paul is rejoicing because of what he calls your participation in the gospel. This word participation is a Greek word. I'm going to pronounce it only because it may sound familiar to your ear. It is the Greek word koinonia, from which we derive the more common English word fellowship. And when he says your participation in the gospel, he's talking about your fellowship in the gospel. And this participation, really koinonia, refers to sharing something in common. The idea is almost to be business partners in the same business, in the same enterprise. That's how the word is used in Luke 5, verse 7, when Peter and Andrew and James and John were partners together in the same fishing enterprise, the same fishing business. And we would say in the vernacular, they were in the same boat together. That's what the word fellowship means, that we're involved in the same industry, in the same enterprise, and we share the same possessions. And what a common participation we have in the gospel of Jesus Christ. That there is no union that is any stronger than what we have with other believers in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It runs more intimate than even flesh and blood family relationships. As I pastored in my last church, I had a couple of pews over here on the side that I referred to as my widow's pew. Their husbands were still alive. They were just unbelievers. And so they would come to church by themselves. And these were very upstanding women, very fine women. And they would come to church by themselves, and they all sat together, and we became their church family. I mean, we became their family in Christ. And the unity and the bond of deep commitment one to another that we had with them, as well as to everyone else in the church. This speaks of the depth of relationship that we have in the gospel of Jesus Christ. It transcends all of our differences. And we have differences in personality, we have differences in background, we have differences in economic status, we have differences in social position, we have differences in IQ, we have differences in personality, we have differences in schooling, we have all kinds of differences. But what rises above it all is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and it brings us together in a common partnership. And that is what Paul says here in verse 5, in view of your participation in the gospel, in view of your fellowship in the gospel, it was a joint enterprise. They had the same mission, which is to reach the world for Christ. They had the same message, which is the person and work of Christ. They had the same motive, which is the glory of God. They had the same method, which was prayer and personal evangelism. They had the same master, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. They had the same mercy, which was the grace of God. And they had the same might, which was the power of the Holy Spirit within them. And I want to assure you, that far overshadows every other difference that would divide us as believers in Jesus Christ. What a glorious thing is going to be when we arrive one day in heaven, and there are no more superficial distinctions and differences in the body of Christ, that our oneness in Christ will be fully realized. In Galatians 3, verse 28, Paul writes, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither male nor free man, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." In Ephesians 2, verse 15, he says, so that he himself, referring to Christ, might make the two into one new man, meaning Jew and Gentile, one new man in Christ. Ephesians 4, verse 4, he says, there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father. This is our oneness in Christ. And Paul tells us in Ephesians 4 that we are to be diligent to preserve the unity of the faith in the bond of Christ. God has made us one. We must preserve this unity that he has made. And so this is our partnership in the gospel. It is found in our common faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ. George Whitefield was a great evangelist from yesterday. And when he would preach in the 18th century, probably the greatest evangelist that ever walked the earth since the Apostle Paul. And George Whitefield in his sermon would sometime look up to heaven as though he's having an imaginary conversation with heaven. And he would say, "Are there any Presbyterians there in heaven?" And Whitefield would say, "Well, the answer is no. There are no Presbyterians in heaven." You might say, "I knew that would be true." Just kidding. And then he would say, "Are there any Baptists in heaven?" And he said, the voice from heaven said, "No, there are no Baptists in heaven." You could hear the sigh and the shock. "Are there any independents in heaven?" "No, there are no independents in heaven." "Then who is in heaven?" And the answer is, only those who have believed the gospel of Jesus Christ. That there are no man-made labels in heaven. There are not different rooms in heaven. And we have all of one denomination in one room and another of another denomination in another room. Someone says, "Do you think only Baptists are going to heaven?" I'm more narrow-minded than that. I don't even think all the Baptists are going to get to heaven. It's only those who have been washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ will enter the gates of heaven. And this is our common fellowship, one believer to another. No matter where you go to church, no matter what denomination you're in, no matter what your style of worship, no matter what your form of church government, no matter what the sign says out front, if you are a true believer in Jesus Christ, then you are my brother and you are my sister. And I am to love you and to show you a special love. That is a family love. And that is what is taking place here tonight. Let us do everything that we can to preserve the unity that we have between brothers and sisters in Christ. Other churches in the area, they're not our competitors. They are our brothers and sisters in Christ. And I tell you one thing that will really fuse us together will be when the persecution hits that's coming to America, we will be clinging to one another. Second, not only the our participation or our partnership in the gospel. But I want you to note, second, in verse 6, our preservation by the gospel, because the gospel that initially saved us is the gospel that will keep us all the way to glory. Notice verse 6, for I am confident of this very thing. Paul isn't just dogmatic about this, he is bulldogmatic about this. Paul is confident of this very thing. He has an unwavering, unshakable certainty about this, that he, referring to God, who began a good work in you, will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. When he began this good work in you, refers to what he says at the end of verse 5, the first day when you first believed, when God first opened your eyes and first opened your heart and first opened your ears and first brought you to himself, when you entered through the narrow gate and entered into the kingdom of light and left behind the kingdom of darkness, and when you became a child of God, he says, when he began a good work in you, it's referring to the converting grace of God, the regenerating grace of God. Notice it says, he will perfect it. That is to say, he will bring it to completion. He will bring it to finality. This word perfect, he will perfect it. It's the same word that Jesus used in John 19, verse 30, as he hung upon the cross and said, it is finished. Meaning he had brought the work of redemption to its perfect consummation. There is nothing left to do. It's the very same word that Paul uses here when he says that he will perfect it. The it refers to the work of God's grace and salvation in your life. How long will he perfect this work? And the answer is, he says, until the day of Christ Jesus. The day of Christ Jesus refers to the day when Christ returns and he comes back for us, his church. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, the trumpet of God and the voice of the archangel, and the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. That's the day of Christ. Or it is the day when you die and you go immediately into the presence of Christ. Either way, it's when you will be face to face with Jesus Christ. And what he says here is, this gospel that unites us is the gospel that will take us all the way home. And not a one of us will be separated from one another. Not a one of us will be left behind. But everyone who puts their faith in this gospel will be ushered all the way into the immediate presence of the Lord Jesus Christ in heaven. It is this gospel that gives to us eternal life. It is this gospel that makes us eternally secure in Christ. And there is a very real sense in which we have been saved, I am being saved, and I will be saved, one continuous work of salvation. And those whom he foreknew, he predestined, and whom he predestined, he called, and whom he called, he justified, and whom he justified, he glorified. I mean, there is God's unbreakable chain of saving grace from eternity past to eternity future, and there are no dropouts along the way. All kept by the power of God's grace as revealed in the gospel. There are no holes in the gospel through which any of us will ever leak out and be lost. And there are no cracks in the gospel through which any believer will slip through and perish. And the gospel is a divinely sturdy bridge connected at both ends that will take you from where you are to where the throne of God is in heaven, and not a one will perish and not a one will be lost. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them from my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no man shall pluck them from his hand. We are eternally secure in the Lord Jesus Christ, and it is this gospel that is powerful to save, and it is mighty to save, and all who put their trust and faith in this gospel will never perish and will never fall from grace. Have you put your faith in this gospel? Have you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Have you committed your life to Him? Have you turned away from a life of sin? And have you repented of your sin and entrusted your life to the saving hands of Jesus Christ? If you put your hands, put your life into the hands of Christ, those nail-pierced hands will never drop a single believer. And you are as safe for heaven this day and as certain for heaven this day as though you've already been there 10,000 years. In fact, when he says those whom he foreknew, he predestined, he called, he justified, he glorified, when he says glorified, he puts it in a verb tense as though it has already happened. That is how secure this gospel is. That is how mighty to save this gospel is. But there's one more heading that I want you to note as we look at verse 7. We have seen our partnership in the gospel, that we're one in Christ. And we have seen our preservation by the gospel, that we are eternally secure in Christ until the day of Christ Jesus. I want you to see, finally, our persecution for the gospel. Because all who believe in the gospel will pay a price for the gospel. Paul goes on to talk about this in verse 7 as it relates to his own life. But it's not only for Paul, it is for all of us who believe in Christ. He says, "For it is only right for me to feel this way about you, because I have you in my heart." I understand this. I understand what it is to preach the gospel someplace, and for people to be birthed into the kingdom, and for you to pray with them as they enter into the kingdom. There is a special bond that you have with that person all of your life. And if you haven't even seen them for 20 years, when you do run into them, there is this strong connection that you feel with those toward whom God has used you to bring them to faith in Jesus Christ. That's what Paul is saying here. And by the way, I think the greatest joy in all the world is to know Christ. And the second greatest joy in all the world is to be used by God so that others will know Christ. That's what Paul, the joy that he has, and how he carries them in his heart, because it was under his ministry that they were sovereignly birthed into the kingdom of heaven. He goes on to say, "For it was not only right for me to feel this way about you, because I have you in my heart, since both in my imprisonment and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers of grace with me." For Paul to be a believer in this gospel and to be a preacher of this gospel, it meant these three words: imprisonment and defense and confirmation. It's an echo of what he would say to Timothy in 2 Timothy 2. Where he says, "All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." Timothy was not exempt from that. And there would be challenging waters into which he would sail as Paul would pass away. And the same is true for each and every one of us here tonight. There is a suffering for the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ that is real. Paul said in Acts 14, verse 22, "Through many tribulations we must enter the kingdom of God." And that Timothy passage that I said. It's 2 Timothy 3:12. As you're in Philippians 1, look at verse 29. This is a sobering verse. Philippians 1, verse 29. He says, "For to you," and the "you" refers to all the believers there in the church at Philippi, and by extension, to all believers in every place who would pick up this letter and read it. "For to you," as differentiated from the world, "for to you it has been granted." The idea "granted" is given as a gift. "For Christ's sake, not only to believe in him." Let's stop right there. None of us can believe in Christ unless it has been granted by Christ. The faith that we have in Christ is the faith that has come from Christ. He has given us the gifts of repentance and faith. And without those gifts, none of us would have ever believed upon the Lord Jesus Christ. We were dead in trespasses and sin. Our eyes were blinded spiritually. Our ears were deaf. Our heart was resistant and hardened. And it was by the operation of the Holy Spirit of God within us who opened our heart and took out our heart of stone and gave us a heart of flesh and then gave us the gift of saving faith and induced labor by which we were birthed into the kingdom. This has all come as a grace gift from the head of the church who is building his church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. But note the end of verse 29. There's a second grace gift that's given. First is to believe in Christ, but also to suffer for his sake. It's a package deal. All who receive the gift of saving faith receive the challenge of suffering for Christ. While he was here on the earth, he suffered for us. He's gone to heaven, and we now suffer for him. And we are to stand out in this world as lights on a dark night. And we cut against the grain of this world. And we are now entering a period of time in America that is unprecedented in the history of this land, that resembles what other empires and other nations and other dynasties have had to go through, with intense opposition against the message of Jesus Christ. Right now, across the ocean, ISIS is literally decapitating believers. And there have been more Christians martyred in the 20th century than in the first 19 centuries combined. And Jesus said it would be this way as the end of the age approaches. There would be wars and rumors of wars, but those who belong to the Lord will persevere to the end. But it is this suffering for Christ that is a part of our mutual fellowship in the gospel. You see, the more you and I are out in the world and flying the flag of our witness for Christ, the more the world is going to be resisting us and opposing us even more. It's changing before our very eyes. And the mercy of that is that it will drive us closer and closer together when we come together to worship. As we're out in the world, we will be chased and harassed. We will be insulted. We will be cast out of circles. We will be persecuted. And some may even be put to death. Some will be imprisoned. Some will be incarcerated for their faith in Jesus Christ. And when we come together to worship as a body of believers, we will just be glad to be with someone who loves me, because we will be so hated in the world. That day is coming. And Jesus said, if they hated me, they will hate you. For the slave is not greater than the master. And if they hated the master, they will hate the slave. And that is the reality of the Christian life, and all the more so for us. And so Paul says that because of the gospel, in verse 7, he says, my imprisonment. Literally in the original language, it's in my chains, in my shackles, in my bonds. I mean, he literally is in iron chains, held fast in house arrest, and having to give a defense for the faith, which means that there is opposition to the gospel, and there is persecution and tribulation. But Paul holds fast and he gives a defense of the gospel, which is a confirmation of the gospel, whether it is believed or whether it is not believed. This is what will bond our hearts together even more, as we perhaps may be like the early Christians meeting in the catacombs under the streets of Rome, as we may be one day like the French Huguenots meeting behind mountains and behind barns, coming together with someone watching to signal to us before the government would come or our oppressors would come to capture us and to take us off. We may be one day like the pilgrims in the hull of the Mayflower, looking for a land where they can worship Christ according to their own conscience. In the front of my preaching Bible, I carry a picture of John Rogers. You may never have heard of the name of John Rogers, born in the year 1500. He was put to death in 1555. He was the first Marian martyr. He was the first believer tied to a stake and torched to death by Bloody Mary, who was the Queen of England at the time. Because of his firm commitment to the gospel of Jesus Christ, and they did it in front of his church to intimidate his congregation. And we're coming after you next. And Bloody Mary did come after some 300 believers and women and children included in this, and had them burned at the stake because of their allegiance to the purity of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I say that not to scare you, but to bring the realization of these verses closer to your heart. Yes, we are united by the gospel, and we are co-laborers together. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. And we have put our faith in the gospel that will take us all the way home to heaven until the day of Christ Jesus. But until then, we will pay a price in one way or another for the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is true of Christians around the world. And just because we live in a country that once had a Christian past does not mean we will be immune from it. But it will be a part of sweetening our unity in the gospel, as we will be praying for one another even more, to hold fast and to hold faithful to the end, as we would sing with one another, perhaps in a secluded place, as we would meet in little pockets of people to hear the word of God read and ministered to us. As I bring this to conclusion, united by the gospel, I have to ask you, are you united by the gospel? Are you united to God by the gospel? Are you united to the brothers and sisters in Christ here tonight? Because just because someone is in church does not mean they are a Christian. Now, you can have your name on a church roll, but not in the Lamb's Book of Life. It's not profession of Christ that will take you to heaven. It's possession of Christ that will take you to heaven. Jesus had a small group Bible study with 12 men, and one of them was a devil. One of them perished and went to his own place when he died. And so I want to ask you, are you born again? Do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? Except you be born again, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. That which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I say to you, you must be born again. You need a new beginning. You need a new heart. You need a new life. You need what only God can give you. And so I want to call you to look to the Lord Jesus Christ tonight, if you've never been converted, to put your faith and put your trust in Him. There's a way that seems right to a man, but the end thereof is the end of death. But there is salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Every other religion leads to hell. Every other path that claims to lead to God leads to the flames below. There is only one way to the Father and only one way to heaven, and it is found in the perfect life and substitutionary death of the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you've never committed your life to Christ, if you've never believed this gospel, I gladly offer this gospel to you tonight. It is purchased through the blood of Christ and offered to you as a free gift. And you must simply, by faith, turn away from a life of sin and turn to Jesus Christ and say, Lord Jesus, have mercy upon me, the sinner. Come confessing your sin. He's come not for good people. He's come for bad people. He's the physician who's come not for those who are well. He's come for those who are sick. Tell Him how sick you are in your sin. Tell Him how you have fallen short of His glory. Tell Him how you know that there is no basis by which you can find acceptance with God in and of yourself. Tell Him you need Him as your Savior and as your Lord. Surrender your life to Him. Entrust all that you are to the Lord Jesus Christ. And by faith, receive Him as your Lord and Savior. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if you will believe in Christ, He will forgive you of your sins. He will robe you in His perfect righteousness. He will adopt you and take you into His family. He will give you a legacy and an inheritance in heaven. You will be the most blessed of all people on the earth. And when you die, He will take you immediately into the presence of the Father. And there you will be around the throne of grace throughout all the ages to come. You'll drink of the water of life, of the river of life. You'll eat from the tree of life, and you will have the greatest of all blessings. You will see God face to face. The beatific vision. So why would you delay? Why would you procrastinate? Why would you put off committing your life to Christ? If you will come to Him on His terms, He says, Him who comes unto me, I will in no wise cast out. Perhaps you're that one tonight. And after the service is over, I know our pastor or any others would love to pray with you and to talk to you about what it is to be a Christian and to enter into the kingdom of heaven.